Hello and welcome to the character of Cobh. This short film is the culmination of two previous exhibitions focusing on some of the more colourful characters who live and who have lived in Cobh, as sadly some of them have since passed away. I felt it was important to record their memories and stories about what the town means to them and growing up in such a colourful and unique place. And I hope you take away from it a story that focuses more on the people of the town than anything that's been done previously about the town itself. Thank you, and I hope you enjoy it.
Sam, can you tell us a little about these very colourful huts that we see just behind us all along the beach area here?
The sheds are they belong to the fishermen or Cobh.
Yeah.
And well, as far as I know, the fishermen of Cobh owns this place down here, like the harbour board thinks they own the place, like, you know. But they don't own it at all. This place was built for from the, what you call it,
Quakers.
The Quakers built this place, like, and it was always for the fishermen, and they built it for fishermen, like, and the people of Cobh. And by the crowds come down and they take it over. They don't want us to be down there. They have yellow lines down, all that. We have to stay inside the yellow line, like, you know. We're like convicts down here, you know. But we take no notice of money, but we still go ahead, like, do what we have to do. It's been done for generations and generations, and it will be done for generations and generations. They're the ones that should move. They're blocking us. For a beautiful harbour, like, there's not a punt on the river or anything. So I suppose you can't blame them, moor off a punt down here, like, with the harbour board and the whole lot. They're taking over this place, they're taking over the camber up above, and they're taking over the railway side and the whole lot, the water's edge. They just come along, put up a sign, and you just obey, and that's it, like. Nah. No, this place is dead now, like. Date. Used to be great, like, people down here swimming up, you know, out the quay and all that. Like, they have a big gangway out there onto them boats out there, and we can't tie up alongside them, and we can't get up and down the gangway if we come in punts or anything like that. No. They want the whole place to themselves, like, you know, which is wrong, like. I don't know objection being there, like, but if they just leave the bloody mineral one, like, and that's it. Coming down, putting up signs for this, signs for that, and signs for everything. And taking over down the railway station and everything, sure.
Would you have noticed much of a change in the water quality in the harbour since the time when you were a young lad?
Oh, it did, yes. Years ago you had it, but then again there's a bigger population here now, like now, oh God almighty, the sort of, I wouldn't go swimming, I wouldn't eat anything out of this harbour. I wouldn't eat any kind of a fish out of this harbour. If I was starving, I'd probably eat you now before I eat a fish out of that harbour, like that. And that's being honest, like, nah. No, it's manky, like. But then again, you had Pfizer's and Net and all them places. The sores come down from Cork and everything. All. And the population's after massive in Cobh now. Like. The pipes are not capable for them, like, and they won't be able to do it. So, you know, that's the only thing I can think about it anyway, like. But they do nothing, like, the place is falling to pieces, like, down here. So there's no more fishing over here now. There's only a handful of punts. The fishermen are gone. Well, what were fishermen what that were here, like?
Well, I still remember the first day that I came here. And it was another barber that got me here. And the thing was, both of us had served the time with the same man, just down there on the hill there, just below. And I was coming along the road and he stopped me and he said that if I wanted to come, I was working in Cork at the time, that if I wanted to come back to Cobh, he said there'd be a vacancy there. Because there was a barber shop here originally as well, but the guy was going away or something. And so I came down and I'm here since. But it was a different town then. This was a very busy street that time. Because most of the people who lived in the east side of the town and the country people would be in this way. And the other women would be down early in the morning with to do their shopping. And it had to be a very busy town. But now it's gone to bits. Well, the area along here, one go, is called the Holy Ground. Now you say, why the Holy Ground? Well, there are two stories. One is that it was actually a red light area, because there was if you went further along towards Koskinny, there was facilities there for the sailors that would be camped outside, and you know, they could row in there and get all their facilities, whatever they needed, food as well as other things. And there used to be a policeman that crossed here, and the youngsters coming this way, younger fellas, they would be turned back. Oh, there was a everything was a shop. There was actually two butcher shops here, just here, this area, a couple of cobblers, and other shops along there. Yeah, it was a very bustling place, and you had a swimming pool down this area, the east side there, and that was also used for delousing people going to America. Before they go, they had to go down there and get deloused. And then in my time, it was a dance hall. And that's where I did my early dancing down there. Although first of all, it was up there, the GA had their club house up there, and they used to have the Kaylee dancing. So we started there. And then after a couple of months, then we went down to myself and my buddy, we went down to the one down there, it's called the Atlantic Ballroom. It was for the ballroom dancing. And that was the start of it. It used to be there on a Sunday night. You couldn't have a dance here on a Saturday night because the clergy wouldn't allow it, because they said you'd be too tired to get up for Mass on the Sunday. So it had to be a Sunday night. So it was a fine hall as well. And they'd have an MC in those days, but they don't have any more. And if you were, like, the rock and roll came in then, and fellas would be doing rock and roll, and he'd come down and he'd stop them. If it wasn't announced, you couldn't do the rock and roll. Even though they'd play the tunes, but you couldn't do the rock and roll unless it was announced. And he'd be down and you'd be dancing rock and roll in the corner and you'd see him coming. So you leave that corner, you run along to the next one. But That was the way. And it was very well crowded there. Crowd used to come down from Cork and for it as well. So it was a very popular dance hall. But then the Cobh Ramblers Club, then they opened a hall downtown, down by the Commodore. And they got the crowds because they got better bands coming down from Cork and that sort of thing. So that band, that place then closed down. So they were there for a long time until they built their own place above on the top of the hill.
Well, I've known Tommy for many years. We live in Harper Road together. He's one of the finest dancers I've ever seen. He's been teaching people for years. He's an outstanding dancer. He does Latin American ballroom, jive. You name it, he does it. My family has lived in Cobh since 1888, when my great-grandfather, Thomas Brierley, came to Cobh. He was the captain of a tugboat called the Flying Fish. He married a local girl called Donovan in Aurelia Terrace. He had 13 kids. He had two died. He was a captain of the tugboat when the Lusitania tragedy occurred. He, like all the other boatmen in the harbour, were called up. It took him a half an hour to get the steam up in the boat, in the tender. He towed smaller boats out to where the tragedy happened, and the smaller boats picked up the survivors and the dead and brought them to the tenders while they made their way back in to Cobh, or Queenstown as it was then. The other smaller boats picked up the rest of the bodies. They had their orders to bring the bodies back to Cobh and the survivors, where the people of Cobh turned out magnificently. In fact, it was probably their finest hour, because they gave people a bed to sleep in, spare clothes, you name it. It was done in Cobh, like. There was one particular man, himself and his daughter and a young boy, they dived off the side of the ship and in going into the water they lost the boy, and he went around to all the morgues in Cobh and he went to all the guest houses and eventually he found him in a bed, where there was blankets put, and it was a happy moment, needless to say. The town turned out for the burial to the old church. There's, when they made it to the old church, there's two mass graves there. And my grandfather, or great-grandfather, is buried down the way from the two mass graves. So when we visit him, were visiting those interred in the Lusitania graves.
They used to put the bodies in there, like, and people off to Lusitania. There was two brothers in there. They were fishing down off the bay there and they got lost. One bad night. I didn't know them, like, but I heard tell of them, like, you know. They were the only, the last two that I know was in there, like. But there was a lot of bodies in there, all right, like. Down through the years. But, it hasn't been used for years, you know, anyway, like, you know.
Yeah.
But I don't think they use them now anyway, like, you know, they're too modern now today.
There are stories I've heard about coal being washed up along the shoreline here. Can you throw any light on those, or have you heard any of these stories yourself, Sam, over the years?
Oh, yeah, but that would be long to then, when the British were here. Yeah. You get it in Spike down on the front of Spike, the back of Harbourne, but it's gone now, like. Oh yeah, big lumps of coal, like, lumps of, for the old steamboats. If you dredge in the harbour, like, don't know, like, crawl for them, like, don't know what I mean, but they don't trawl. You get them, like, the coal, and it's the best that you could still use it, like. Oh yeah, oh yeah, I've often used it, like, I often got it there on Spike and by the pier. But there's only one thing then, sometimes then, like, what often happened to me, like, I get the coal, and there might be a lump of pitch in between it, like, and you wouldn't know the difference between that until you light the fire, and then you're in trouble. Oh, Jesus. Ah, that's it, no. That, oh, yeah, plenty of coal, though.
What do you think is the biggest change in Cobh since the time when you were a young lad?
Yeah. My God, there is changes very big. Well, the population, for one, anyway, God, no one knows who's who. Years ago, everybody knew who was who and who was related to who. You know, nobody knows. No, and that's a fact, like, you just have no clue who they are. No, but, like, even the whole of Cobh, like, changed, like. I mean, you go back of the island there and the whole of the buildings and houses and things. That's why all the sewerage pipes are blocked up and everything, so. You know, there's too much population there, like. And.
Would you remember the Holy Ground when it was booming? Would you send, like, all the shops and, say, from Harrow?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Holy.
There used to be a pub up there as well.
There was a. I forget the name of the one that was up behind us now, but there was.
There was Mars.
There was a pub here. And there was Joanie's. And there was Massey Pluck sitting up on the top of the hill, the Anchor, the Horizon. Oh, there was about 36, 37 pubs there one time.
There's shops all the way around.
And shops, yeah. Perry, Dick, Stella, what's her name? I can't think of her name now. She had a shoe shop, like. Oh, yeah, there was Mr. Spain. Yeah, and butcher shops and everything, they're all gone, no shop. post offices gone. They're all gone. They're all gone, bear me. Ah, yeah. But I worked on the tenders, going out to the liners, all right, a couple of years ago, when the old liners used to come in. You might often get two in the harbour, but they used to come in here, like into the station. You make a couple of bob later on. But them days are gone now and all, like. I mean, we were really looking at Yanks then, like, you know what I mean? With these liners coming in, like, you don't know who they are. What they are. They're probably as badly off as we are, like. I think some of them are, anyway. They don't spend much here, no.
When you had Sharky and Adam that time,
didn't
you?
Oh, you had Sharky and Danny Jordan. Oh, there was a rake of dockers here and all that one time. Yeah. But they're all gone. They're all gone. Like when you look over there and we see Irish Steel gone later on. That was a great boom to the town, like. Look at it now, they're making a car park out of the place over there. For what, I don't know, like. Who wants to go there in the middle of nowhere, like, park your car? Unless they put a cinema or something up there. They might make a couple of bob then. Thousands and millions for that place over there. Millions. And we're still poisoned. Poisoned from it. Yeah.
What's your best memory, Sam, of living in Cobh?
Mine? Oh. Best when you could come down here and get mackerel and what have you, like, you know. They'd be jumping on the strand and you could go swimming down here, down the park.
It all started about in 2011 on a Patrick's Day parade in Cobh, and I decided I had a beautiful Victorian dress and I thought I'd love to wear it, and I didn't ask anybody to go with me, but I decided I'd go by myself. And when I arrived at the Heritage Centre, everybody said, wow. And it all started, I walked in the parade and a group from Crosshaven joined me. And they were artistic as well, and they were very impressed. So that's where it all started. I got an opportunity to go to the Heritage Centre, where we set up base there and we meet and greet all the passengers from all the liners that come here right through the summer, and for functions, very prestigious functions at the Heritage Centre during the winter season. And we love meeting people.
We do.
Then I was very lucky to meet Malcolm, who's absolutely a great ambassador for Cobh Heritage Vintage Era.
So yeah, who's done a bit of acting himself and been in the town for 18 years and... Emily, I don't know how we met, but we met accidentally on purpose. Certainly
through music.
Through music, and yeah, we've been together ever since, haven't we?
Yes. So
when we have the time.
Exactly. So I have a great interest in, you know, costumes clothing and style, and especially Victorian era. And there we set up a group, and we're at the Cobh Heritage now in nearly 4 years. And we love every minute of it. We meet people from all over the world.
All walks, yeah.
My very first visit to Cobh was, I worked in Crosshaven, and on that occasion, there was a folk festival, dance festival in Cobh, and they were picking some girls and whatever for a Blarney Rose, and I was chosen to represent Crosshaven. So when I came to Cobh, I thought I was after coming to New York. I come originally from West Cork in a very small country place. So to me, it was like going to America. And I was in, oh my God, it was, the reception was at the Commodore then, and then we went on a parade along the town with horse-drawn carriages, and oh my God, I was so taken aback. I didn't win, but look, it was lovely to be participating. And that's how I came to Cobh. I
moved to Cobh and loved the place and started the gardens and did the flowers and various other bits and pieces. But from the theatre side of things, I've been there since I was 6 years of age in the theatre, doing all sorts of things, Snow White, Snow Queen, Joseph and his Technicolor Dreamcoat, Oliver Twist, King and I, and a few others to go on with. So the theatre side of things I love, and the dressing up I love indeed as well. And love all the outfits as well. And Emily always does so well with her dressing. It's just unbelievable that, yeah, we match unbelievably when we don't even live in the same houses, but we arrive with the same outfits so most times.
It works.
So, yeah, it works. It works. It does. It does well. And, yes, we enjoy the people. And we run around the town doing all sorts of things, visiting and meeting all the people. And a lot of them, we end up either dancing or doing something on the keys, which they seem to enjoy. And it's always lovely to bid them farewell from the lovely place of Cobh. Emily, do you remember I asked you to come up to Bloom because we were part of Cobh, and then
right.
And asked you to sort of come up just as dressed up as part of the setup and so forth. And of course, you arrived with such beauty that it caused an absolute stir from the station right up to the park.
So we arrived in Houston, and as we arrived in Houston, we thought, geez, do they think we're very special or something?
Yeah, so and you could hardly get into the hall or into the function because everybody had stopped to take pictures.
Anyway, we eventually came to this part opened up the ropes for us to come in, and I looked, and there was Michael D. Higgins and his wife Sabrina.
Yes, Sabrina.
And oh my God, they were so delighted to meet and greet us.
And they remember they invited us to Bloomsday.
They invited us then to Bloomsday.
Remember, the friend of yours gave you the necklace too. That lent you the necklace.
Oh, that's right. That was the. That was that one, I'm sure.
Yeah.
So that's kind of my life story. I've been very lucky in life. I am extremely lucky. Great, beautiful family. I've had my heartaches too. But look, the good overrules the not so good. So that's my story.
Moving on to happier times, do you know anything about that chap who used to bury himself and try and set all kinds of records?
Oh, Tim Hayes.
Would you have known him, and can you tell us anything at all about him?
I would have known him, but he'd be older than me, like. I just, he was a great character altogether, like. I mean, when he went down in Cobh there, like, it was amazing altogether, because we had televisions that time, like. They were only after coming in. And he was on television, like. When he went down in Banmore that time, like, you know, when he got buried down there, he was down there for over a week or something, I think. I'm not sure now how long he was down there. I was there the night he came up all right, like, you know. But, he got great publicity out of it, like, yeah, without a doubt. But he beat the record anyway, like, and that was good, like, good for Cobh as well, like, it was packed, you know. So that's the only thing I can tell you about him anyway, you know. He was the only man that said, like, going to a funeral like that, the only difference with the funeral is the man getting buried is walking behind the hearse. He done a bit of nails, yeah, down in Max Bar, well, it used to be called the Saints that time. Oh yeah, I don't know how many hours he done on it, like, but he done that for charity, like. But he went down a good few times, like. Yeah.
You knew some of the other characters, Sammy, didn't you? You knew, like, all the guys that were setting the records that time, like.
Wallow.
Wallow was staying awake, and there was another guy eating sausages.
There was Tony Lane.
What was his, what record did he try to set?
To eat as much sausages as he could. He didn't get the record, like, but he certainly got a load of sausages, like. He definitely didn't get the record, but he got a load of sausages.
And it was the same with Timmy, or
Cole,
wasn't it?
Oh yeah, he had to go to sleep and stay awake in a rocking chair, like, in winter's night, like, winter time. And a big blazing fire. And he was caught there one night. Two old women or something came in, and people used to have to sign the book what time they go in and what time they come out, like. They went in, two boys were in there, they were full up. Sleep. So he lost the record, but he got a hell of a lot of coal out of it, like. And I mean, he got a lot of coal, like. So he gained out of it, like. He wanted to go up a pole another time. I don't know what the lady. But the doctors and things wouldn't have that, like. Stay up from the pole, ESB pole, like, and
sit up on top of it?
No, climb up on top of it, be strapped onto it up there, like, and stay up there for beat the record. Then he wanted to go down in Ballymore, empty beer barrels, a normal grave, like, but empty beer barrels. But, of course, the doctors wouldn't have to check him for all this, like, they said, no, they wouldn't. So he couldn't do that either, like. But that was all to go at that time, like, you know. They were liable to come up with anything, like. But there was nothing else to do, like. So.
There were some great characters at that time, wasn't there?
Ah, yeah. Oh, jeez. A lot better than what's around today, I can guarantee you that. Oh, a lot better. There's some characters around now, but they weren't anything like these guys were, like. Oh, they wrote a book in it. So the crowd that's going around now wouldn't even know what a character is. And that's the truth, like, yeah.